know, Don said it really well this morning about just being here. You're here for a reason. God brought you here for a reason, right? And yeah, it's a nice picture, and yeah, it's so cool the way God just speaks, right, to different people and gives them words of encouragement and stuff, right? All right, yeah, so good morning, right? Welcome. You guys, thank you, worship team. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for just showing up, right? The joy of the Lord is in this house. I know I shared that already this morning. I'm just going to pray quickly for the word. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you. I thank you for this word that you have. And it just speaks to every one of us. Holy Spirit, just open our hearts to what you have for us today. Open our ears to, not that we just hear it, but that we live it and we do it and we walk through it. Because you are tilling our hearts. And Father, I just pray as we till, we can tolerate it. Right? But Father, I just thank you for this word. I just pray that in Jesus' precious name. I don't know how I'm going to get through. I don't know if I'm going to make it through all of this or not. We'll see. But I'm going to ask you guys first off and foremost, if I have your permission to be transparent. I want to be as transparent with you as possible. Okay? And vulnerable, right? I'm a person. I know I'm your pastor, but I want to be vulnerable. I want to be honest and open and show you. So we've been diving into the word about letting God just till our hearts. Guess what happened? Guess what's happened over the last 2 weeks? God has been tilling. Has it been easy? No. No. It has not. I was actually going to come today and just kind of trail off from what Jed was talking about last week about the priest, about Jesus being the priest. And I thank you, Jed, that you shared an awesome word last week, right? Some good teaching, right? Because God's speaking to you and through your heart. And so I thank you for that, right? You know, and I don't know about you guys. Have you guys been letting God dig in your hearts? Right. It's not easy. It hurts, but it needs to happen. It needs to happen. You see, last week I came here and, oh man, I'm so thankful. I even said to Jed, and maybe I didn't give him enough time to prepare, but he already had that on his heart. Thank heavens that God already placed that in his heart. But I couldn't share last week. My heart was not in the right place. My heart was ugly. As Pastor Dave would say, the uglies, right? I was so stuck. I was so stuck last week. And if you looked at me last week, it was just a, ugh, right? I just, bah, bah. I was just stuck, right? He put me in this place of contemplation, too. Because as we were talking about the heart, right? What's he doing in my heart? I was like, well, I don't know if I want you to do that in my heart. And then I'm in this place where it's starting to not feel good. And then, of course, situations come up that help you check your heart, right? It's like, oh, the situation, this is not good, right? And, you know, I got in that ugly zone. And, you know, when you get it, it's the grumpies on roids, right? And if you know me, and I've shared this before, my nature, my old past nature was that I get Eeyore-isms. Right? Oh, it's gonna do it anyway. You know, that kind of thing. But I am so thankful that Jed preached last week because God was speaking to me even in that message, and I needed to hear that too. Right? Not even so much that God is the refuge, but there was a specific part that I was like, okay, Thank you. Thank you. I need to be ministered to. Amen, right? I do. But you see, God was drawing me into something that needed growth, that needs growth. So Proverbs 14:12, NIV. And you'll see I do not have a PowerPoint because this is all coming from somewhere else. I don't need PowerPoints for this. Okay? I wasn't even going to put this on notes, but I had to put my thoughts onto words and onto paper because if I didn't, it's not going to go well. There is a way that appears to be right, but it leads to death. I'm just going to leave you with that passage to think about as I'm walking through this. So I want to give you a little bit of my testimony. Some of you guys may not know me. Some of you guys do know me and so on, right? And I know that Kim, we went to school together, so you knew me as a kid. I was a terror, right? She agrees. She knows, right? But you know, my child was really rough. My childhood was rough. Not saying diminishing anybody else's, but it was rough. It came from a place of the school of hard knocks, literally. Right? You know, all kinds of abuse, physical, mental, sexual, right? And in the heart of a two-year-old kid, something happened. I learned to be protective, and I learned to be independent for survival at 2 years old. I tell you, I had very little fears. And I'll share some of that in a minute. And I'm sure that for my mom, and mom, if you are watching, I'm sorry that I probably took off 10 years of your life. And that's not a joke. When I was about 3 or 4 years old, we lived in BC. And I would sneak out of the house at 3 o'clock in the morning to go shopping. We lived in a second story apartment. I would climb out of the story apartment, go down, and I would go shopping about 3 or 4 in the morning. That's not smart as a kid, right? My mom would phone the police, and I would hide from the popo. Right? I'd hide from them. Unbeknownst to me, there was also a serial killer that was targeting kids at that time in that area. Yeah, and I became an escape artist. Nothing could hold me down. My mom actually physically tied me down to the bed, locked every door, every way possible, got out of bed. I knew how to lift the glass out of the window to get out. And I got out. Yeah, nothing could hold me down. But you see, most of this I forget. Over time, right? But I do remember some things. And through the tragedy of everything that I went through, you see, something still pulled me out of this place of a cycle to fall into this place where abuse, sexual abuse, all of those things, something pulled me out of there. And I know what it is. It was God. God was protecting me, and God was changing something in me. I didn't realize he had a calling on my life at that time and why he was intervening in something there. And I thank God he did. And he did. I share this with you. I shouldn't be here. Honestly, I should not be here. So many times God's pulled me from harm where I should be dead. I should be dead. And if you were a teacher, so Cassandra, you'd know this. If you see this, I would have been what they would call a strong-willed child, right? I would have been a strong-willed child. You could not hold me down. You could not contain me. Right? Today you'd say that might be ADHD or whatever you want to label it as, or however that is. It's just misplaced love. It's misplaced things. But yeah, I was pretty wild. I was pretty reckless. Yeah, Kim's agreeing. Yeah, thanks, Kim. It's okay. You're just attesting that I'm not lying. Right? And I was a strong-willed kid. I was a strong-willed kid. Not really in a bad way, but learn to be strong, street smart, right? Street smart and unafraid. I'm going to tell you, that's not advisable. I was relatively stupid, right? But as a kid, you don't understand. But you see, what this did was set up a pattern in my life. It set up a pattern in my life, both good and bad, right? That I'm going to share with you, and I'm going to lay it all out. You see, 2 weeks ago, we laid it all out at the foot of Jesus, did we not? We said, we want our hearts stilled. We laid it out. Oh, I wasn't expecting to be so soon. Actually, I did. Maybe I wasn't prepared for it. So that we might have new growth. And guess what? God showed up. God showed me what needed to be tilled up. He showed me what needed to be tilled up. Let's say that's why I had the grumpies for the last couple days. Although I didn't know that. Then a close friend of me, a friend of mine, said some words just in passing in discussion that we were having. And when I went home, they echoed so heavy in my spirit. And you know when God does that? He wants you to do something about it. When he keeps echoing in your spirit. So as I shared some of these struggles that I was having without battling an eye or even a flutter, right? They said, it isn't about you. It's about God. I've heard that before. Many times. But something started resonating. And it started resonating like a gong. Right? Maybe my heart before wasn't prepared to hear those words. But this started resonating like a gong. And they said, that's pride, was the next statement. Okay. And I just shrugged it off. And I agreed, and I moved on with my day. Right? And we had a good day, right? After that, some things started, I'm feeling a little better, this is good, right? But when I got home, that what started as a small whisper got louder. And it got louder. And as I spent my day in prayer, and the next day, bang, goes the gong. Hit me like a hammer. And he hit me with this. You've been fighting so long alone. What is that? I'm going to give you the word. And it's hurt. It feels, it's prickly. It's called pride. Pride. And we're in our men's group, and what are we talking about in men's group? We're watching some comedic video, and they're talking about pride. Right? And he's making fun of it, in light of it. But it's like, man, God, you're just pouring that into me. You're just speaking that. And that's pride for me that came from a survival mechanism. And I've been aware of that for a long time. And I thought I dealt with some of that, but God is tilling it up. Here's what's more interesting, and this is funny. I love my wife. I do. I love her to death. I didn't share with Dawn that I was dealing with this pride thing. Because you know what? That would be insecurity in my pride if I shared my pride with her, that I had to let go of that. I didn't want to share it with her. Right?
I just think, I'll just keep that thought in my head, because you know what? That hurts another part of me. Can you guess what that is? It's called ego. That hurts my ego. You know, yeah. And you know, when you see someone taking, yeah, hang on a second, I'm going to go here for a second. Oh, yeah. And so, how many of you guys, we watch movies where there's this amazing last stand, right? And we glorify this last stand, right? Hell or high water, I'm not doing that, right? Right? Why does that appeal to us, right? Like General Custer's last stand, the Alamo, those kinds of things, right? You know, I don't know if you guys remember, I'm dating myself, I'm sorry. Some of you young ones have no clue what I'm talking about. There was a show called Young Guns. It's a newer uptake on Billy the Kid story, kind of fun, right? And that was very much the same premise, right? Is there a bunch of outlaws making a last stand and all of this stuff. Why does that appeal to us? Because we know our stubbornness could easily put us in the same position, right? So we're going to talk about stubbornness just for a second. And I looked up this meaning, and it's a dogged determination not to change one's attitude or position on something. Let's go back to our word. What was that? Yeah. There's a way that appears to be right, but in the end it leads to death. Okay. Wow. I want to look at some of these other terms, and sometimes they're kind of ouchy, or we think, right? Like hardened, self-willed, headstrong. And then you put a couple animals in there, you're either bullheaded or you're pig-headed. Whew. Ouch. We see our insistence on going the way that seems right to man might satisfy our rebellious souls. We were not made to be rebels. We were not made to be rebels. And then we have this thing where our pride has come hell or high water. I'm not going to succumb to that. You see, that pride is a quality or state of being proud, right? And this is funny. We'd rather die than surrender our ego. That's not what God says. Just let your ego go. Die to your ego and follow me. That's the fleshly way to look at it, right? And I know I even said, you know what? I'm not going to let the boat go down without a fight. That was also a check in my spirit from something that I said. And then you hear this, right? The glory, right? And even in that show, and if you're a Bon Jovi fan, sucks to be you, but no, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm teasing. Right? There was a song called Blaze of Glory, even from that movie called Young Guns. And what is a blaze of glory? Blaze of glory is a self-righteous attitude that we put on. That comes from bringing glory to yourself. Right? If I'm going to go down, I'm going to go down with all the guns blazing. Right? And that is and for me as a martial artist, that's a samurai mentality, right? That is a worldly mentality, right? I'm going to bring honor to myself and my family. What is that? Look, Jesus himself gave himself up for others, not to glorify himself, but to glorify the Heavenly Father. Jesus died to free us from that nature. And when we do that, when we take that last stand, it's ego feeding. And I don't know what about you guys, but I love playing with words. I love play on words and stuff like this. I know Cassandra probably enjoys that. So ego is exemplification. That's a big word. But exemplification is example of something, right? Gone overboard. Right? Exemplification gone overboard. So how do we let go of pride? How do we let go of pride? Forgiveness first. Forgiveness first. You go to God, forgive me. You go to other people, forgive them. Let go. And this is the word that God has been hammering in my heart for 2 weeks. And you'll recognize this, guys, from the men's group. Let go, let God. Let go, let God. Work in and through you. Let go. Stop doing it yourself. God. Work in and through you. And here's the hard part. I don't know. To walk in humility and humbleness. To walk in humility and humbleness. And humble means a lower modest view of one's importance. And humility is a lower modest humbleness, which is a freedom from pride and arrogance. You see, humility is a moral realm, the result of a fresh revelation of God. And there's three elements that humility has. One, recognition we need God. Two, ouch, here comes the ouchy one. A realistic evaluation of your abilities. And three, a willingness to serve with a heart, a servant's heart. You know, the way up with God is always down. I want you to understand that the way up with God is always down. That's why we have to be broken first to go to God. If we went to Him on our own, just willy-nilly, is it actually from our heart? No. It's a place where we need God. We need our brokenness. The place where we are most broken, where we need God. As our focus, our human focus, is usually on up and more. That's a fleshly look. Up and more. First Peter 5, 1 and 6, and this is from NIV. If you want to throw it up there, Jed, that'd be great. This is for me. This is for you. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that's under your care, watching over them. Not because you must, but because you're willing. As God wants you to be. Not about pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording over them or those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. That spoke heavy to me. As a pastor, as your pastor. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Now, verse 5. And in the same way, you who are younger, submit yourself to your elders. Here's the point. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. And then verse 6, it says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. In that passage, clothed with humility is not a suggestion. It's a command. It's a command. Humility promises to exalt us at the proper time, not ourselves lifting ourselves up in a blaze of glory, or all of those things. Proverbs 13:33, humility comes before honor. James 14:10 says, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. Luke 1:52, listen. He brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. Humility is the key to successful relationships. Humility looks like this. I'm going to read you a story that I read in one of my devotionals. And I'm going to tell you it broke me. Looks like this. You want to see what church looks like? Listen to this. Dr. Helbeck, a missionary of the Church of England, south of Africa, from the top of the neighborhood hill, saw leopards at work. Not leopards, lepers, okay? He noticed two in particular sowing peas in the field. One of the lepers has no hands. And the other had no feet, because those were wasted away from leprosy. The one who wanted the hands was carrying the other, who wanted the feet, and upon his back. And then he carried again, and he again carried the bag of seed and dropped a pea every now and then, which the other pressed into the ground with his feet. So they managed to work of one man between the two. I just want you to picture that for a minute. They didn't wallow in their pity. I wish I had hands, I can't do nothing. I wish I had feet, I can't go anywhere. But in the love of each other and for a purpose, they carried each other to pursue purpose together. That's what humility looks like. That's what humility looks like. It's esteeming others. It's lifting them up. It's lifting the other one up, and it's burdening the other person. Sharing the load. It's a fruit of repentance. And I say that because you look at that, and it's, I need you. Right? We need each other. And it's an attitude which rejoices in the success of others. It's the freedom from having to be right. It's a mark of authenticity. It's a fruit of brokenness. It's the quality that catches God's attention. Catches his attention, and it's the foundation of unity. And this should be as such with the body of Christ, the true union of Christ's body, and have the same care for one another. Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love, honor one another above yourself. That is the path of humility. So today, as I seen that powerful picture, it was a powerful picture that just spoke to me, broke my heart. But it encouraged me. It encouraged me. Because that's how the body of Christ is to function. It gave me a picture of how we're to function as a church. And I'm telling you right now, coming from a place of humility, I need each and every one of you, just as God needs each and every one of you to fulfill his purpose. Right? I do. I need each and every one of you. I love you, but I do. I can't do it alone. I have to suck up my pride. say, hey, I need you. And I need each one of you. And I come humbly before you as your leader. Ask for forgiveness for my pride. I do. I stand before you and ask for forgiveness for my pride. And as we press forward, that we might fight together in unity. Enough about me. Here's the best part. Here's the best part. So even though we might be in this place, or not in this place, but we're at that place where we're maybe glorifying that this is the last stand, or that we're going to take a last stand, or what stand am I fighting for, right? As we take this, look, despite our insistence to go our own way, we still long for a last-minute rescue, do we not? Right? And it's like, oh, this is what I'm going to do, but I still hope somebody's going to rescue me, right? And no matter how far down the valley of death we may go, there is one that we can count on to save us. Amen? There is one we can count on to save us. Right? And he did. He does save us. But we have to let him. Instead of fighting him, fighting what he's got for us, fighting our ego, fighting our pride, fighting all our circumstances of what we have. Whatever circumstance, God is bigger than your circumstance, I'm sorry. It feels like the circumstance is big, but God is bigger, absolutely. And he's going to walk you through it. And I know I shared part of this yesterday, but you know, we don't walk through the valley of the shadow of death alone. We don't. God walks with us. And what do we need to put to death today that God wants to walk you through? Because he says this, let go, let God do the work. And you know, Jesus pulls more rescues than the Calvary ever does. Right? And that is the way that leads to life. Opposite of what? The path that we think leads to death. Jesus leads to life. Let him do the work. As we kneel as servants at the foot of the Lord, ready and willing to serve him and his people, he will lift us up. Amen. He will lift us up. Let go. Let God. I'm tired. I thank God. I thank God through all this pain, all this sorrow, all this suffering, all this stuff. They tilled my heart. I was bagged. I was weary. I was worn out. And last night I got a fresh anointing. The water washed over me. And then what does my wife say? She's talking about the effects of water that she just kind of came across, a reflection of water and a revelation of this water thing. That God is sovereign over water. Remember I shouldn't steal your thunder. I'm sorry, Don. Right? Before we were, there was water and the life, and the word was void. Everything was void. There was just water. And what does Jesus do? He floods the earth with water. What does he do? He calms the storm. The water. He has authority over water. Right? So he's just showing his authority through water. Guys, we're 80% water. Think about that. Do you give him authority over you? I wasn't going to share that, but thank you for that peace. So let's lift him up in humility and humbleness as we come before him. I just want to pray. I want to thank you guys for just letting me be vulnerable. I thought I was going to be more sobby, but I am so thankful for the God tilling my heart, because those weeds need to be plucked out because they were poisonous. And the funny thing that God does is he puts you through a process and an application in your life. Right? It's like, you need to walk it out. So he puts people in. Oh, you need to go talk to this person and work it out. Okay? Done. Was it easy? No, but it was fun. It was fun to see what I was doing. And there was joy in that. Anyway. Whatever it is today that this speaks to you about, I think we all carry some form of pride. Right? And God tells us to just be humble. So whenever you're faced with a situation, your situation isn't that big that we cannot let it go and let God deal with it. So I'm just going to pray. Jesus, I thank you. I thank you that you humbled yourself to show us that way. You didn't have to. But you did. You absolutely did. You rescued us from death. You didn't have to, but you did. You humbled yourself. And in fact, here's something for you guys to remember. He humbled himself before his enemy. Remember on the Last Supper, he didn't ignore Judas. He didn't ignore him. He washed his feet just as everybody else. And he said, do what you have to do quickly. But he humbled himself before his enemy even. We need to do the same. Not to humble to the enemy, but humble ourselves that much to our brothers and sisters, because they're not our enemy. They are our brothers and our sisters and our family. Father, I thank you. I thank you for this church. I thank you for what you are doing here, Father. Father, we just pray for strength as you're tilling us. Father, that you are encouraging us through this time of tilling and this time where we need to let go of things. And Father, we just lay pride at your feet. Not to pick it up again, but to lay it at your feet. Father, I thank you that just to use the situation as an example so that you might be glorified. Father, I thank you for each one here. Father, I just pray for their health, their safety, and their growth in this process. Keep them safe. I just pray that in Jesus' precious name. Amen.